Transformation Resources Committee will be receiving updates and reports on our very form. So that sort of came out of the discretionary housing funds. So and the welfare rights unit has got to discuss what we did and how that impacted on our form. So we're due to have updates and tools in March. But I think generally that we had some really useful discussion through where all making a decision on the night. I thought it was very beneficial.
So you quite like shares, isn't it? 2C132, the EIA is completely published on the council website, really providing, hopefully, the general public, and not least those disadvantaged, but vulnerable, with the opportunity of how the decisions that we take actually take the considerations into account. Paragraph 2.6 is set out in two separate ways. From 2.61 to 2.67, we try to highlight a number of the employee initiatives that we have within the council. And I'll draw your attention just to a couple, Chair. The first one is about our reasonable adjustments policy. That's been really successful over the past 12 months. One thing we do, we have budget responsibility for each of the reasonable adjustments. Originally sat within each budget output, so if somebody came along and did have some acquired issue that needed to be resolved, it would be down to that budget output to resolve it. Clearly that would slow the process down, didn't get coordination, actually didn't get best value out of some of the aspects. Drew out of each budget holder an amount of money which this month stands at £25,000. And what you can see there is that £10,000 of that was actually allocated for specific text help software licences, which actually would have cost us in the region of £25,000 on their own, had we done it on an incremental basis. So we're seeing not only the impact being felt by those people that need that software, but also doing it in such a constructive way that we actually save money as well. In terms of the equality profiling for the staff, that's been very much updated, and you can see all the changes in law, we continue to monitor this, such as the change of law around equal marriage and shared parental leave. And then finally, just to draw your attention, Chair, to an employee engagement panel, which I think is quite exciting, really. I'm looking for up to 200 people across the organisation. They won't replace the opportunities and the formal agreements that we have with the trade unions. But what they will do is have an opportunity to have some soft discussions around any proposals for policy development, for what our next steps are in terms of learning modules, etc. So hopefully they will also represent all the protected groups so that we are really getting to the heart of the diversity of our workforce. In terms of both those issues from 2.68, they relate to hopefully initiatives which do have an impact directly on the residents. Firstly, in terms of 2.68, we've got the notion of becoming the first council to have our living wage, which was the first for local authorities around here. And clearly, we also then stretched that out and actually offer discounts to local businesses in terms of their business rate if they were able to do the same. Rural's Family Intervention Programme, clearly that's a national programme that's been ongoing for a couple of years now in various iterations and various formats. We've seen some significant success in terms of the life of very vulnerable families, particularly those with multiple complex needs. And we have seen some absolute results and outcomes from that, particularly around reductions in domestic violence, antisocial behaviour, and drug and alcohol misuse. Over the page, we've had some awards. You can see in terms of our public health campaigns, through both public health and environmental health, in terms of our takeaway for change in Eat Rural, which hopefully will stand us in good stead in terms of improving life chances for people as we go through our particular pledges. And finally, two issues that were led predominantly through the constituencies. We see the Wirral West constituency team coordinating Stay Safe at Rural and Well project. That's got some significant benefits in terms of just the campaign, in terms of working with alongside Merseyside Fire Rescue Service, but also around home energy, healthy homes, and working with HUK around some of the pop-in and defending services. And also, I think, particularly around for those people who might feel vulnerable because of their particular circumstances, particularly around disability, the Safe in Town card, Wellesley Birkenhead, which really means that for those people who are out and about in the town, they can, if they feel anxious or get into difficulty, there are a number of drop-in places they can go to, which are effectively shops which are there to help and support vulnerable people. Finally, Chair, just in terms of the successes, I think one thing that I know has been raised previously was around the notion of having support carers and 2.619. I think demonstrates that in terms of our carers strategy, how we are just developing our support mechanism for carers if you need in advance of the changes in legislation. In terms of planned activities for next year, you can see those set out in 2.7, Chair. One thing that I would say is for 2.75, trying to develop best practice models
to August 2015. How could you talk about best practice and equality when you weren't treating staff equally, when some not appraisers and some didn't? And my understanding of equality is that everybody's treated equally. And we will make it so that people are equal by helping them to reach that point. So by not appraising people, you're not only not promoting equality, you're actually being negative about it.
So it's pretty much the same point in a different way, but it's more around on the appraisals there's automatic renewal, automatic annual review, and reasonable adjustments part of the appraisal. Again, not everyone's getting appraised, is this going to affect it?
I mean, what we will say in advance of the next items on the agenda is that that information is historically, it's out of date, and the more current information tells a much better story. However, I'm not the officer, I'm not the officer.
So it's June 2015, which shows me the time.
I left it in, I let you answer. So you take it.
Well, I'd have a mapping against the
blood. Yeah,
improvement in our sickness absence levels. So I'm really hopeful that we'll see that in course through. Because in terms of what you're seeing at this moment in time, is a little bit behind. I think that's probably one of the consequences we were talking about this week, around just in terms of because we dedicate so much time around the policy and performance committees pre-Christmas in terms of budget setting process, we kind of miss a cycle. So we might need to rethink that in future years.
I've got some of the various, if you don't mind, it'd be a bit of a list of them, and then I'll ask what people feel. Attendance day in the year, it picks up a point that we've made several times, this one's been agreed on with target and improving performance. However, if you look at another set of data, it will one of the worst in the country for daily attendance for alcohol related conditions.
Sorry, what page do you want to
show? On page 60. And so that's one. I would just like to highlight that. I think something we have talked about, and it's led to the discussions which has led us to developing a different set of indicators, which I think we're going to be starting with in the new municipal year. I just want to comment on that, how it can mislead if we just look at the grant rating. And on the opiate users and non-opiate drug users, I know we've had a change of provider, and I know these are 5 months new actual date, but are there any comments on those statistics and what the picture is now, a little bit further down the line? Do you want to go forward, Julie?
Sure.
It's on page 16.
Yes. Yes, Chair, I think this data is quite old now, as you just highlighted, but our performance in the report that you've got does still put us actually in the top quartile within the country.
On
any? Oh, sorry, I was talking about opiates. Yeah, is that okay? I'll come back to me on that. So, from the opiates point of view, we are still in the top quartile of performance nationally. So it's still good news. We need to get better, and then there's the pushing the new provider, CRI, to achieve the target that we've set for them. I think this is an indicator that I do need to highlight to the committee that we do expect to see a decline in performance, because it's we're actually reporting on data that's probably 12 months old. It's the way that the data is reported, in so much as we have new presentations into the service, which takes place within a 6 month period of people leaving. So it's quite a complicated indicator. We can provide more detail on how the indicator is worked out for committee members' interest. But I think the message I wanted to give tonight was that we're still in this, the top quartile nationally for performance. We do think we'll see a decline over the next few months, because that's when we have a lot of transition issues, as people are aware of, and there's a lot of flux in the system. But we really tightly monitoring the contract going forward. And what I can report is that we are now seeing a lot more service users on a reducing regime, which is what the move was all about. So on transfer, we have 50 service users who were reducing their use of Rapido. We've now got over 200. Who are on a reducing a regime, and we've also seen a reduction in presentations within 6 months of leaving the service. So we're now at a re-presentation rate of around about 10%, and it was 30% on transfer. So I think what you've got in front of you is a snapshot in time. Things have moved on significantly, but I think the reporting that you will get will always be, you'll have a poorer picture in the next few years.
Yes.
Yeah,
between September and now, if you are not physically able to do that next year, you're stuck with a whole pile of people now, aren't you, having their appraisal at the same time. Unless you can make some sort of provision for that every year, every single September, those figures, that percentage is going to dip, isn't it?
Yeah, I think that's very important, the transformation resources policy and performance committee. This is something that starts on the 1st of April. We expect and hold the managers to account to ensure that they undertake the performance appraisals. They don't wait until there's a run for people who are around in September. There's absolutely no reason why a manager cannot undertake a performance appraisal for a member of staff well within the time scale. So there's
right.
no need for
right. So my next question is then, because you have that big number of people, have you got in place that people will now be appraised so across the year it's equal numbers? Is that now in place?
Yeah, it's always been in place. I think it's an issue that we've brought forward in terms of compliance with the managers. The issue is that from the 1st of April, everybody should have a performance appraisal. And
I think we take the point, sorry to cut across you, but I think we take the point Christina's made. I think we're going to have to take on board that there is the potential for performance to dip this time next year if there are a large number of people needing to be done in a short period of time, and leave officers to report how that situation is dealt with.
That's what I'm asking. How will it be managed is what I'm asking.
Okay. Steve.
Thank you, Chair. Page 59, CSC, the rates looked after children. And I've mentioned this in the past, and it's concerning. The narrative to this seems to be getting stronger and stronger, and obviously all of us here were like, well, that's looked after children, but looked after children are looked after because they need to be looked after. Setting of targets, how they're implemented is obviously the definition of what I was thinking here. But there's words like a decreasing target has been set. There's also tighter control of processes to reduce the number of children in care. I'm just hoping that there's some strategies to try and...
We do talk about these at length, the families and wellbeing.
Yeah, okay, on that, I'm just saying, I hear it.
No, and to say,
it's worrying to me.
It's something that, you know, the word that goes with this is, this must be done safely. And I mean, we won't get officers from children and people here. We will raise this again in families. We do constantly look at this. The operative word here is, we are out of line. We are out of line with other authorities. We are able to take more children into care and they stay in care longer, and that is not a good situation. But the word that Julie will always use is, this must be done safely. But we ask the questions that come into that. Right, are we happy to note that?
Yes.
I've got the financial monitoring.
Yeah, thank you.
I'm going to answer my question. vouched at the floor pavilion. I think it would be helpful for members to have that and to discuss it.